Thank you, Aniva, for that kind introduction and to the team ARC for this opportunity. And after all the clinical talks, we are now going over to how to read an OCT, which is purely an imaging talk. And it is extremely a vast thing to cover in 10 to 12 minutes, but I'll try to do my best giving some clinical examples. So I have no financial disclosures. We are very, familiar with radiological investigations, be it PET scan, MRI. But what is the differentiation between OCT and all these are? Those are of the diagnostic capability, they are low resolution and at an organ level. Whereas the biggest advantage of OCT would be that it is actually giving us even at a cellular level. It's literally like an optical biopsy. So if you look at it, it also gives us a lot of the histological details, right, from the retina up to the choroid. As you can see here, there is a good comparison between the spectral domain OCT and the retinal histological layer comparison, and you can actually see each and every layer very well delineated. So this is again the big advantage of OCT. So it is quick, it is non-invasive, it is reproducible, and it is definitely indispensable as our clinical practice resumes. And I will cover today's talk with the principle, the evolution, some common protocols that I use, and how to read an OCT scan, common retinal conditions as well. So coming to the principle of OCT itself, it's like an optical analog of the ultrasound imaging that uses low coherence interferometry to produce cross-sectional images of the retina. So it uses infrared light from a superluminescent diode that is divided into two parts, one of which is reflected from a reference mirror and the other is scattered from the biological tissue. So these two are then reflected to produce the interference pattern to produce the echo, and multiple A scans are then collated to get a good two-dimensional image. So that's as far as the principle goes. Going on to the evolution, a lot of seniors in this group here, they have seen right from the stratus up till the swept source now. So this is the different time domain to the swept source that we have seen over the years. And it has only improved our experience with OCT with better resolution and better detailing. So this is a table that compares the three different types that we have, and the light source is different, and the range of imaging also is different up till the enhanced depth imaging that we have now, which is giving us a lot of details about the choroid as well. So that has become an important add to our armamentarium. So coming to the different scan protocols, before that, this is how the device looks. So this is what we have at our institute and we've been using now. So you have a chin rest, you have an adjustment panel, and you have a touch panel which gives you the sensitivity knob, the joystick. So these are the different objective lenses, et cetera, that you can go over into detail when you're examining a patient. You have a raster scan, which is a series of parallel line scans that can be oriented in any angle. It gives us very high resolution imaging of the pathology. Radial scan we use very often. Important here is that it gives the relationship of the lesion with respect to the fovea, which is very important for us because we know that foveal lesions cause more visual disturbance to the patient than others. Also, we get a 3D scan. This is especially important when you're looking at the topographic maps. You want to look at volume. Again, you have different protocols for that. So for a good scan acquisition, you should have preferably a well-dilated pupil. But even with smaller pupils, we do get good scans. Appropriate protocol should be selected. The patient should be instructed to look at the internal target. Also, the OCT image should be upright and straight, and the reference scan pattern should ideally be centered on the fovea or on the area of interest. Adjust the light entry point across the pupil to get the best signal strength, and the saved OCT scans should also be looked for both qualitatively and quantitatively. So this was a small video that I had to show how the acquisition is done after actually including all the patient's parameters, the details, whatever is required, the required protocol is selected, and the scanning is started. The patient, like I mentioned before, is given a target for fixation. And then once you get the good illumination and a good scan strength, you can go ahead acquiring these images. So there you are. You can see the patient position. You can see the scanning protocol coming into view there, very nicely focused. So this is when you start acquiring the image. There. So now going on next. How do you read an OCT scan? So before going into the details of that, this is something that we all need to learn and be aware of. This is the international nomenclature for OCT and the different layers. Initially, we used to use terms like ISOS, which is still there for a lot of classifications, but more recently, there's the ellipsoid zone, the myoid zone, and the interdigitation zone that is used. So we need to be aware of that. Every time you look at the scan, important things that you need to identify: the patient's name, the age, the gender, the race. These could have a bearing on your treatment as well. So it's important, identify the eye, because again, you're treating it, you need to make sure which eye you're treating. The signal strength and the direction of the line scan is also important. So this is a good signal strength that you see above compared to the one below. The reasons could be various. It could be even media opacities. We need to be aware of that. And this is the direction of the scan that is also extremely important. Now, going on to looking at the pathology, we look at it at the preretinal, the epiretinal, intraretinal, and subretinal lesions as well. Important two things that you see in an OCT is whether it is hyperreflective or hyporeflective. So there are different layers which are hyperreflective, which you need to look at. It's mostly the OPL, the IPL, and also some pathology. I will show you a table which will be easy as a reference for you all. And hyporeflective is mostly the nuclear layers, the outer nuclear, the inner nuclear, and the ganglia. So again, hyporeflective are intraretinal and subretinal fluid as well. So this is a good table which will tell us both the normal lesions, the normal and lesions, pathological lesions, which are hyper and hyporeflective. That was as far as the different layers go and how they look on a normal scan. Qualitative analysis of the OCT, you describe by the location, the form, the structure. If you see any anomalous structures, again, you have to identify them, and also the reflective qualities, like I mentioned just now. That was qualitative, but now going on to quantitative, this becomes important, especially when we're treating patients. Different instruments have different segmentation algorithms to look at the retinal thickness. So this is the layers of the retina, which are very well segmented, and this is also possible, automated. So macular thickness, especially important because we're dealing here with a lot of diseases, and macular automatically affects the visual acuity and quality. So it's important for us to know, and also to compare whether there's response to treatment. So this is again a video which shows us how the thickness comes. And not only in the center, you can also move the scan across to see what the thickness is, fovea, parafoveal, all that information also it's possible once you drag the scan. So coming to common retinal conditions, I'm just going to skim through these conditions. Going on to vitreomacular interface disorders, it's extremely important. You have VMT, which so many times is not picked up clinically because it's very subtle. So OCT is definitely a great tool to help us. You can have focal or you can have broad-based vitreomacular traction. It could be asymptomatic. Patient could have metamorphopsia, altered fovea on clinical examination. Obviously, depending on the symptoms, we base our treatment. Epiretinal membrane, again, there are different groups, classifications based on the OCT itself, all available in literature, and you can go through. Again, very useful for us to determine whether a patient needs to undergo surgical management or not. Here, I wanted to show you that each of the devices has a different cutoff for thickness. So it's very important to base your diagnosis on whether the retinal thickening is there or not, on which instrument you're using. Macular hole provides a confirmation of your clinical findings, anatomical characterization. Very useful to educate patients. The minute you show them a gap in the retina, they understand why they're having metamorphopsia or a gap in their vision. And improved staging of the macular hole also possible. So these are again OCT-based classifications or staging of macular hole. Helps us in various indices to prognosticate and to plan surgery as well. And also to look at hole closure post-surgery again. Useful to show the patient how successful the surgery has been. To differentiate between lamellar macular hole and pseudo hole, also very well possible on the OCT. Sometimes clinically may be difficult to distinguish, but here it is possible. Going on to retinal vascular disorders, extremely important for thickness assessment, patterns of DME, deciding the treatment protocol for DME, quantification of the CME in vein occlusions, which Dr. Lalit Verma just spoke about, monitoring response to treatment, and also prognosticate the pathology and whether the treatment is going to help or not. So patterns of OCT and DME, there are several, and this is the OCT classification, the spongy, the cystoid, the subretinal fluid, whether there is a tractional component, and these are all extremely important for treatment, medical or surgical. So we have the diffuse, you have the CME, you have the serous retinal detachment, and then here you have the traction. This is pre and post treatment. You can see resolution of the traction. Obviously, vision improvement is good. Then here again, where you see it in severe forms of PDR as well, you can see a tractional component. Vein occlusion, whether there is cystoid macular edema, whether there is subretinal fluid, again, a prognostic aid for follow-up as well, and to see whether there are any complications. Central retinal artery occlusion, again, both in acute and chronic phase, you can see inner retinal thickening versus thinning, and you can see this hyporeflectivity as well of the inner retinal layers. DRAO, again another example here where you can see one half being normal whereas the other not. AMD, useful tool. We are basing a lot of our treatment only on the OCT. This is in dry AMD where you can see the monitoring of the disease progression, very important for us because especially with patients with geographic atrophy, even a small island of vision is extremely important. Exudative AMD can show us the type of CNVM, which layer it lies in. FFA-ICG correlation also possible. You want to look at intra and subretinal fluid, the types of PED and response to anti-VEGF, where you can see here post-injection, very good resolution. Central serous retinopathy, now with the pachychoroid spectrum, OCT has become very useful. You can see the extent, the PED, follow-up, response to treatment and complications as well. This is again post-treatment. You can see resolution of the fluid. Myopia, very difficult because the contrast is much reduced on clinical examination. So we can pick up subtle lesions also, especially CNVMs. And also for myopic foveoscices, it has really changed our management, how we can see on OCT whether a patient requires treatment or not. And also the different type of myopic foveoscices is very well delineated on OCT. Solar retinopathy, again, subtly you can see some changes where you can see inner photoreceptor damage in the earlier stages and also RP changes later. But we do see a persisting central defect in these patients. Ocular trauma again shows us formation of macular hole, outer retinal changes, choroidal ruptures, decision making and prognosis, it does help us. RP as well, you can see loss of the photoreceptors, you can see thinning, and you can also see cystoid changes, which does not necessarily show leakage on the angiography. There were some questions in the beginning of this on biomarkers, so I had not included it. I thought I'll just do a quick run through for DME biomarkers on OCT, imaging biomarkers. So quickly, hyperreflective dots, these are well-subscribed particles, 20 to 40 microns in diameter. They are equal or higher reflectivity to the RP band. The origin is still very unclear, but it does help us. So when there are few compared to moderate and then compared to many. So how does it help us clinically is that it has showed that eyes that responded to Ozurdex or dexmethasone had more HRDs. And eyes with several HRDs, the inflammatory pathway might contribute more to the pathogenesis and therefore anti-inflammatory drugs may be more effective. This is from literature. Somebody had asked also about drill. So how does this help us? Basically, drill is defined as a horizontal extent in microns for which any boundaries between the ganglion cell, inner plexiform layer complex and the inner nuclear layer and outer plexiform layers cannot be identified on a clear scan. So this is where drill is present versus drill is absent. And the association of drill has a bearing on visual acuity. And for every drill increase of approximately 300 microns from baseline, there was reduction in visual acuity by one line. And disruption has been due to a snap in the bipolar axons. Again, here ISOS, regular versus continuous irregularity and discontinuity. So presence of SRF, ISOS continuity and absent HRFs and an attached vitreoretinal interface are basically biomarkers that predict better visual outcome. To conclude, while a clinical examination is extremely important, OCT has helped us with confirmation of diagnosis in ambiguous cases, classifying disease better, planning intervention, monitoring treatment and progression of the disease, prognosis, extremely important here again, and an educative tool both for us and for our patients. Thank you so much.